Penguin Random House Audio presents Soldiers Don't Go Mad, a story of brotherhood, poetry, and mental illness during the First World War by Charles Glass. Read for you by Edward Glass. In grateful memory of Rob Morell, Alessandro Durensis, and PJ O'Rourke. And it's been proved that soldiers don't go mad unless they lose control of ugly thoughts that drive them out to jabber among the trees. Siegfried Sassoon, Repression of War Experience, 1917. Introduction. All the armies in the Great War had a word for it. The Germans called it Kriegsneurose. The French, La Confusion Mentale de la Guerre. The British, neurasthenia, and, when Dr. Charles Samuel Myers introduced the soldier's slang into medical discourse in 1915, shell shock. 25 years later, it was battle fatigue. By the end of the 20th century, it became post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. In December 1914, a mere 5 months into the war to end war, Britain's armed forces lost 10% of all frontline officers and 4% of enlisted men, the other ranks, to nervous and mental shock. An editorial that month in the British medical journal, The Lancet, lamented, "The frequency with which hysteria, traumatic and otherwise, is showing itself." A year later, the same publication noted that nearly one-third of all admissions into medical wards were for neurasthenia. 21,747 officers, and 490,673 enlisted personnel. Dr. Frederick Walker Mott, director of London's Central Pathological Laboratory, told the Medical Society of London in early 1916, "The employment of high explosives, combined with trench warfare, has produced a new epoch in military medical science." This development need not have surprised Britain's military physicians. Major E.T.F. Birrell of the Royal Army Medical Corps, RAMC, had observed nervous breakdowns in surprising numbers while supervising a Red Cross medical mission to the Balkan Wars between Turks and Bulgarians in 1912 and 1913. The new heavy weapons that Germany's Krupp and other European industrialists sold to both sides inflicted carnage that doctors had not witnessed before. Modern science was creating modern war. Explosive rifle cartridges penetrated flesh more deeply than balls from single-shot muskets. High-explosive artillery shells released not only the shrapnel shards of old, but ear-shattering thunder, blinding light, and a concussion so fierce that it sucked the air away. The shells demolished the strongest ramparts, leaving no refuge. Rapid-fire machine guns mowed down hundreds of men in an instant. Hospital wards received, in addition to those who had lost arms or eyes, disabled soldiers without marks on their flesh. They suffered unexplained blindness, mutism, paralysis, shaking, and nightmares. A surgeon from Belgium's Saint-Jean Hospital, Dr. Octave Laurent, documented the Balkan wounds in his book, La guerre en Bulgarie et en Turquie. Laurent removed metal shards from broken bodies, but surgeons could not cure paralysis, trembling, nightmares, blindness, stammering, and catatonia. Laurent posited physical causes for the symptoms. This accorded with medical and military doctrine of the day that fighting men did not become hysterical. Practitioners in the new field of psychiatry shared the view of Sigmund Freud in Vienna that hysteria, a word derived from the Greek for uterus, was a female condition. Laurent referred to the soldier's malady as La commotion cérébrospinale, a variant of what American Civil War doctors had called windage, undetectable molecular disruption of the spinal cord from the vibration of speeding bullets and shells. Concussion had caused some, but not all, of the neuroses. Laurent's and the RAMC doctors' denial of the emotional causes of physical disabilities would influence the military response to mental illness when Europe's Great War began in the summer of 1914. Industrial-era weaponry deployed on a mass scale from August 1914 to November 1918 exacted a greater toll in dead and wounded than in any previous war. For the first time in history, millions of men faced high-velocity bullets, artillery with previously unimaginable explosive power, modern mortar shells, aerial bombardment, poison gas, and flamethrowers designed to burn them alive. British casualties soared on August 26, 1914, a bare 3 weeks into the war, when German artillery ravaged the British Expeditionary Force, BEF, at Le Cateau in northeast France. In October, the Battle of Ypres produced so many cases of mental shock that the War Office dispatched a leading neurologist, Dr. William Aldrin Turner, of London's National Hospital for the Paralyzed and Epileptic, to France to discover the causes. Examining otherwise healthy men afflicted by deafness, deaf mutism, blindness, stammering, palsies, spasms, paraplegia, acute insomnia, and melancholia, he concluded, in many instances he, the soldier, may persevere with his work until a severe psychical shock, such as seeing one of his friends killed beside him, severe shelling, an upsetting experience, or bad news from home, unsteadies him and precipitates a definite attack of neurasthenia, requiring rest and treatment at home. As the war progressed, doctors recorded an escalating proportion of mental breakdowns alongside the usual statistics of killed, wounded, and missing. The percentage increased as the war froze along a static cordon of opposing trenches from the English Channel south more than 400 miles to the border of neutral Switzerland. Along this deadly frontier, troops of both sides endured the relentless hammering of devastating artillery in a dark, underground world from which the only escape was injury or death. Debate among military physicians and between doctors and senior officers raged over how to deal with the unblooded wounded. Dr. Myers criticized the military for regarding shell-shocked soldiers as either insane and destined for the madhouse or responsible and should be shot. The question persisted throughout the war. Should men who broke down on the field of battle be disciplined or receive medical attention? By war's end, firing squads had executed some, practitioners had administered punishing electric shocks to others, and psychiatrists offered Freudian psychoanalysis to a lucky few. But even then, the treatment's purpose was to thrust shattered boys and men back into the violent conditions that had caused their breakdowns, troubling physicians who had to weigh duty to patients against military necessity. The problem of soldiers' mental health became a crisis in the summer of 1916 when British General Sir Douglas Haig launched an all-out assault to break the German line in northern France's Somme Valley. Preparatory, uncamouflaged massing of forces and supplies, together with a week-long artillery barrage to reduce enemy defences, alerted the Germans to the impending onslaught. At 7:27 on the morning of July 1st, British artillery subsided and an eerie silence prevailed. 2 minutes later, a mountain of earth rocketed into the sky from a spot behind the German lines called the Hawthorne Redoubt, where British sappers detonated a 40,000-pound underground charge. That was the signal for thousands of men laden with 66-pound backpacks to climb over the parapets of the British trenches and march into no man's land. German defenders, who had sheltered deep under the surface during the barrage, emerged to fire machine guns, artillery, and mortars at their attackers. 21-year-old Captain Wilfred Neville, known fondly as Billy to the men of his East Surrey regiment, kicked a soccer ball onto the battlefield and charged forward. As he dribbled the ball into the barbed wire, German gunners cut him down. A fellow officer, Lieutenant Robert Ely Soames, followed with another ball, urging the men to kick it into goal. Few of them made it. Novelist and unofficial war propagandist John Buchan, whose swashbuckling imperial heroes like Richard Hannay had inspired many youngsters to volunteer, described the carnage in his 1917 book, The Battle of the Somme. The British moved forward in line after line, dressed as if on parade. Not a man wavered or broke rank, but minute by minute, the ordered lines melted away under the deluge of high explosive, shrapnel, rifle and machine gun fire. The Germans pitied the boys falling before their bullets, calling them cannon footer, cannon fodder. It was not combat so much as slaughter. Between dawn and dusk, nearly 20,000 British soldiers died, while another 40,000 suffered wounds or went missing in action, the highest one-day loss in British military history before or since. The men and boys who straggled back to their trenches had witnessed unprecedented horror. Close friends, in some cases their own brothers, had been cut to pieces before their eyes. It was more than many could bear. Thousands turned up in casualty clearing stations, CCS, without visible wounds but unable to speak, hear, walk, or stand still. Many were incoherent. Some, fearing terrifying nightmares, dared not sleep. They came from all ranks, a high proportion of them junior officers. Haig pressed the Somme offensive for 4 bloody months of mounting casualties without breaking through.
Dr. Arthur Hurst. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.